The morning of surgery, you'll be checking in at the fountain entrance at 5 a.m. and you will be directed to the same day surgery on the third floor. Once the patient is taken to surgery, the family will be directed to the third floor surgical waiting room.
Here are some important phone numbers for you and your family before surgery. The navigator office is 386-425-1361. The surgeon's office is 386-226-2662. Any questions the night before surgery or on the weekend can be directed to CPCU. The number is 386-425-5491 and ask for the charge nurse.
The most important thing is some of the medications to be holding. We'd like you to make sure you hold drugs that are affecting the clotting factor, such as Coumadin, such as Plavix, Eliquis. We do have a time frame that we will go over that specifically with you. For example, Coumadin would be 5 days, Plavix 5 days, Eliquis 3 to 5 days. Some other medications that we do like you to hold would be like ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers or ARBs. Any of the medications that have prills on the last, like lisinopril, fosinopril, losartan, amisartan, any of those sartan drugs, we like to hold those for at least 3 days because it does affect the blood pressure in the operating room. Expect the patient to arrive with their family about 5 a.m. That gets them time to come in, get prepared, prepped and ready for surgery. We have somebody that usually comes in, make sure you know all the jewelry is removed, secured with the family, the medications. They go over again. Anesthesia will meet with the patient, go over that again, and then usually within that hour and a half, they'll go back to the operating room. You're going to have a tech that's going to be taking the patient, a nurse, a tech that's going to be taking the patient to the operating room. Within that operating room, you'll have a couple of nurses that are circulators. You'll have an anesthesiologist. You'll have a perfusionist that runs the heart-lung machine. You're going to have a first assist that is actually assisting the surgeon at the table. So there's quite a few people in that room. There's probably about 6 or 7 people in the room for each procedure. Surgery will take about 3 to 4 hours, depending on what type of surgery. A valve surgery will take a little bit longer. A lung surgery will take maybe 2 hours. The patient afterwards will be taken directly to the intensive care unit. Usually it'll take about 1 to 2 hours before the family will be able to see the patient. And that's because they're just setting them up, getting them all ready with all the lines and drips and so forth.
My name is Soth Khanna. I'm a cardiothoracic surgeon with UF Health Heart and Vascular Surgery at Halifax Health. So there are a number of prevailing thoughts, but the most popular belief theory is that there is some degree of inflammation or scratch or some intimal trauma in the blood vessel itself, maybe as early as even your childhood, that eventually becomes the source for platelets and other blood products to stick to. Cholesterol and calcium gets deposited in that. Eventually, as that grows into a bigger chunk, it becomes a blockage. As that blockage develops, that blood is compromised, and so the nutrition to that heart muscle is compromised, and the heart muscle is lacking what it needs to do its function. And that can present itself as chest pain or shortness of breath, a whole variety of symptoms. The way we fix that surgically is you create a detour around the blockage, essentially a bypass around the blockage by using arteries inside the chest or veins from other parts of your body to create new conduits or new channels for blood to get beyond the blockage so that oxygenated and nutrition-filled blood can get to the muscle that needs it most. So in terms of expecting before your surgery, you'll come in the morning of surgery most likely unless you're already in the hospital. We'll take you to the operating that morning. The things to expect is that you'll wake up immediately after surgery with a breathing tube, which is hopefully very short-lived, very aggressive in terms of getting that breathing tube off and getting you off the ventilator. You will wake up with a scar down the middle of your chest where we open the breastbone to get to the heart, a couple of drainage tubes in your chest to drain any fluid that may collect afterwards, and certain monitoring devices like a catheter in your hand for blood pressure monitoring, and possibly a catheter or an IV in your neck for using as a big, large IV. Catheter. So our surgical team, which is a core team in the operating room, consists of myself, an assistant, the anesthesiologist, a nurse anesthetist, a surgical technician, a surgical circulating nurse, a perfusionist. That's the main group in the operating room that is present for the entirety of your surgery, afterwards, when you get to the intensive care unit, you have the intensive care nurses, possibly intensive care physician providers, physical therapists, occupational therapists, respiratory therapists. And as you progress through your hospital course, then there's other people involved, such as case management, people that are dietitian that are looking forward towards your discharge planning and making sure that everything is in order for you to go home safely and comfortably. The way to perform the bypasses can be done in one of two ways. The traditional or most commonly performed manner is what's called on pump, where we put the heart on the heart-lung machine, we stop the heart and essentially have the bypass machine take over the function of the heart and lungs. Therefore, you have a still, quiet heart that you're operating on, and once you're done with the bypasses and completing what you need to do, and then we wake the heart back up and take you off the heart-lung machine. The alternative way, which is we're happy enough and proud enough to provide at Halifax, is the off-pump fashion, where we don't stop the heart. We keep the heart beating while we're operating on it and essentially use various mechanical devices to facilitate bypassing or performing that same bypass on a heart while it's still beating. So there are certain risks that are possible or inherent to surgical procedure on a heart. In the most cases, these risks are very, very minimal, less than 1%. However, they are prevalent. There's a chance of having, anytime you create an incision, there's a chance of the wound not healing well, especially if you're diabetic or have other medical issues or comorbidities that put you at a higher risk for not healing factors. There's a risk of bleeding in the operating room or afterwards. The risk of stroke is very small, but there as well, there is a risk of having an abnormal heart rhythm afterwards. It's not a major issue. About 15% of people that have heart surgery will have what's called atrial fibrillation, which is a rapid pacing of one of the chambers of the heart, quite easily and well treated with medications and other therapies that we have. So for the most part, the odds are in your favor that you'll do very well. Beyond those risks, depending upon what other risk factors you have, may predispose you to other possible risks and complications. So after surgery, most likely you'll wake up in the ICU with a big dressing on your chest. That dressing has a vacuum suction on it that stays about 6 to 7 days. In the majority of the patients, the first day or even within 24 or 12 hours after surgery, you're transferred to a step-down care unit where you have a little more privacy, a little more ability to have your family members stay with you. You're still on the monitor, being monitored, and all your heart function, heart rate, blood pressure are being monitored adequately. Generally in the hospital between 4 and 5 days. The entire recovery period is about 6 weeks or so to allow that bone to heal, and that's a time period where you're on what we call sternal precautions. There's no heavy lifting, driving, or exertional activity to allow that breastbone to heal to its best ability. Once that's fully healed, you're pretty much off all limitations as long as you're doing well. In general, you're starting to drive at about 6 weeks' time when the bone is fully healed and you're not taking pain medication. And in terms of your ability to get back to work, depending upon what it involves and how much lifting or strenuous activities involved, but usually between 2 and 6 weeks. Generally, by 6 to 8 weeks, you're back to your normal self and all limitations are off. In general, you'll be on the medications that you were on preoperatively. There are likely to be a couple additions, such as a baby aspirin if you weren't on it. In certain instances, a medication called Plavix, which is kind of a bigger brother of aspirin, to allow platelets to pass through those bypasses without clumping or forming chunks. You're also on a medication called a beta blocker, which is for your heart rate and blood pressure. A statin medication for your cholesterol if you weren't already on one or the other, one of its variants. And then depending upon how your heart rate or your blood pressure or your recovery was, it will determine if there's any additional medications beyond what you were on before surgery.
So we provide a full spectrum of heart valve replacement and repair surgery. And when we talk about repair, usually we're talking about the mitral valve. We also offer a minimally invasive approach in select patients where we can perform that surgery through a small incision in the right chest instead of going through the breastbone, which patients tend to prefer. So in terms of when we're talking about valve replacement, there's different types of valves. There are valves that are made from animal tissue, and there are valves that are mechanical. And which valve we select is mostly based on age, because mechanical valves will last a lot longer than tissue valves. But the caveat is that people with mechanical valves have to take blood thinners their whole life. And a lot of people don't want to do that, depending on their occupation. We also offer transcatheter aortic valve replacement and transcatheter mitral valve implantation in select patients, and that's a field that's growing, and just like with the aortic valve, I think with the mitral valve, 5 or 10 years from now, we'll be doing a whole lot more of mitral valve replacement through through the groin or as a transcatheter approach versus having to do a full open heart procedure now, which I'm sure people will like. Unlike bypass surgery, people who come in for valve surgery usually have heart failure symptoms, which most of the time it's shortness of breath, so it could be leg swelling, lack of energy, and they're usually on medications, which also have side effects for heart failure. So when we can go in and replace the valve or repair the valve, a lot of those medications can be discontinued and the heart will work a lot more efficiently. So people can expect to be able to breathe easier and have their stamina increase following the recovery from the surgery. So the recovery period after this surgery depends on the approach, of course. If it's a transcatheter valve, usually it's 1 or 2 days in the hospital and about a 2-week period where we really should take it easy. If it's a full open heart where you go through the breastbone, it's usually about a 6-week period where you shouldn't lift more than 10 pounds or so. You can walk all you want, and you also shouldn't drive for at least a month. Those are the main limitations, but it's a much longer recovery period if you have to go through the breastbone versus if you go through a different approach. The best thing is to every day do a little bit more, a little more walking, being engaged with your own recovery. Try to eat right, which is sometimes difficult because people usually have less of an appetite after surgery. And that's usually the best thing, is just to stay engaged. If you have a support system with your family, lean on them a little bit, because it will get better. It takes several weeks. People that are working, usually I tell them that if they're in a physical job like construction or something, usually it's a 2 to 3 month period where they might not be able to work. But if they have a desk job, they can go back to work as soon as they feel up.
So I work night shift, and I just want to tell you some of the things that you can expect on the night of surgery. While we do allow your family to come and visit, we ask that concludes before 6:30 p.m. and doesn't start again until after 7:30 p.m. That allows us to change shifts effectively and efficiently, and for us to focus care on your loved one. We do expect you to get out of bed on the day of surgery. This is the first time that you'll be moving around, and you'll really be able to see what it feels like to have to do sternal precautions in a different way that you're going to have to move throughout your recovery. We will try and treat your pain as much as we can, but please understand you won't be pain-free. This is safety for you too, and will help you to know when you reach your limit and what things you should be doing and not be doing. In the morning, we'll be getting lab worked, and this is standard for every patient. We'll also be checking your blood sugar every hour or two overnight. Please rest assured that our team has over 300 years experience in taking care of immediate post-op cardiac surgery patients. We look forward to you beginning your journey to recovery and getting back to living your life well as soon as possible.
He's talking about post-op day one, which would be the morning after your surgery. You'll find yourself up in a chair with your bladder catheter removed. I'll be coming in and we're removing the hemodynamic lines, the lines that we use to monitor your vital signs continuously during the recovery. We'll go over sternal precautions, which are very important. We are a top 50 in the country vascular surgery outcome 2 years in a row. So just go with us. Don't do anything too fast or too slow. Just stay the path. We'll get you home and safe as soon as possible.
Post-op day 2 and 3, you can expect us to weigh you first thing in the morning. We'll get you up to the chair for all your meals using sternal precautions. We're going to walk you up to 6 times a day. We will put your TED hose on in the morning, and we'll take them off before you go to bed at night, and that's to prevent any blood clots from forming in your legs. If you are female, you'll be using a sternal bra. This day you may also get your chest tubes removed. If we do that, you'll get a shower the next day and then every day thereafter. You'll also have a Prevena wound dressing in place for 7 days, and that will be on your chest. We'll also go over all your medications with you, make sure you understand what you're taking. And that's it. Thank you for allowing us to take care of you here at Halifax Health.
Post-op open heart exercise program is vital to your recovery along with your diet. You want to stay active every day. And that's going to include stationary bike and or walking and ambulating is really all you want to do for the first 30 days of your cardiac rehab. First week, inpatient, we're going to be getting you up and out of bed. and ambulating as much as we possibly can, working on deep breathing exercises and coughing. You know, once you get out of the hospital, you want to continue that exercise program and up and ambulating 2 to 4 times a day, at least for 10 to 15 minutes, and you're going to slowly increase that distance daily, depending on how you feel. Remember, listen to your body and what it's telling you, because it will give you an idea of how you're feeling. We would like for you to stay away from the saturated fat and the sugars. Try to limit the amount of red meat your intake is, and focus on your fruits and veggies, and focus on the outside of the grocery store instead of going up and down the aisles. You'll find better food there, healthier food, and there are plenty of apps that you can download to your phone to show you the actual real substance that's in the product you're buying. A plant-based whole food diet is really what you want to focus on with cardiovascular disease. There's evidence that it's able to reverse that. So there's a lot of information out there that you could really search and find, and do the homework, and you'd be surprised how healthy you could be. You want to take your blood pressure and your heart rate each morning, kind of give an idea of what your baseline is, and continue that throughout your recovery, and increase your distance in how you feel each week. You know, gradually you should be getting up to 30 to 45 minutes of a brisk walk. You know, time yourself in the beginning, stop it at the end. It gives you an idea how quick you're going, and you can increase your pace or slow down depending on how you feel. You want to sweat every day, at least once a day. You want to break a sweat. You want to increase your heart rate, get that vascular system, roaring and going. A body in motion stays in motion, and you want to really help yourself after having open heart surgery. And, never stop moving is the best thing you can do.
Following are very important discharge instructions to optimize your recovery. Please take these following precautions. Sternal precautions: we ask that we give a big red heart pillow after surgery. They must do the surgery and separate the breastbone. They put it back together with cables, and we don't want you lifting, pushing, or pulling more than 10 pounds after surgery for 4 to 6 weeks. We give you that heart pillow to hold to remind you not to use your arms to push, pull, or lift more than 10 pounds. And you may also use that to hold on to and splint with coughing. For your activity restrictions, we ask that you wait 30 minutes after any activity before walking. We want you to wait 1 hour after eating before walking, because the blood leaves your heart and goes to your stomach to digest the food, so we don't want to stress your heart. Limit your stair climbing to once per day. Ideally, we want you to do one step at a time, both feet, for balance. You may exercise outside, weather permitting. Your goal is to walk 30 minutes daily by 6 weeks after surgery. For your TED hose, your family will have to assist with applying and removing your stockings, but we do ask you to wear them as much as possible to prevent blood clots and swelling. We do ask that you remove them at night while sleeping to prevent any skin breakdown, and reapply them in the morning. Do not wear them in for your follow-up appointment with your surgeon. Your incentive spirometer, we want you to use every 2 hours while awake for 2 weeks after surgery. And we ask you to splint your incision with that heart pillow while you're coughing. For incision care, we need you to shower daily with antibacterial soap and a fresh, clean washcloth. Wash gently and pat dry, and then leave open to air. Avoid using any powders, creams, lotions, or ointments until completely healed. And watch for any signs of infection, such as redness, swelling, any drainage, yellow, green, gray, or foul smelling. We need you to call the surgeon's office immediately. You may notice a lump or swelling at the top of your chest incision, which may take several months to disappear. But if you notice any new lumps or bumps beneath the skin, these may be signs of infection, and again, we want you to call the surgeon immediately. We do not want you to drive for 4 to 6 weeks after surgery, avoiding any front airbags. At discharge, you will sit in the back seat, away from those front airbags, with your seat belt over your pillow protecting your chest. Females need to wear a clean sternal bra for a minimum of 2 weeks until seen by their surgeon. We discourage smoking and secondhand smoke, as this will inhibit your recovery time. You may have intercourse as soon as you feel like it, but using sternal precautions. If you had a heart attack, wait 4 weeks. You may return to work when approved by the doctor, usually a minimum of 4 to 8 weeks, depending on your type of work.